Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. When you marry fine writing with great historical research, covering monumental people, people of character and dignity, end times, extraordinary times, you get a book that is going to be obviously an award winner. It is called No Ordinary Time, Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt, The Home Front in World War II. It is written by my guest, Doris Kearns Goodwin. It's published by Simon & Schuster. Welcome, Doris.
Thank you, very glad to be here.
And congratulations, this is no ordinary book.
Thank you.
An extraordinary period of time. Not only do we have a president who's running for a third and a fourth term in this period, the whole world's at war. And America is in that in-between stage before December 7th. A president who's had polio since 1921.
Right.
And an extraordinary first lady.
I think what drew me to the subject was the largeness of the people and the drama of the times. I mean, it's so rare to be able to get that connection where you feel like you've got these complicated characters, you could never spend too much time with them and get bored. I still don't know enough about them. And the period of time I would love to have lived through in many ways, when there was a collective sense of identity, when people felt they were fighting a common cause, when the nation was a nation, something we don't feel today.
It begins with really coming out of the Depression. And the war was a means, too, of taking unemployment and putting it on the back burner. But let's focus in, first of all, the White House, which at that point, as I read in the book, it reads like dynasty. You've got all sorts of people, in a sense, in a boarding house that's called the White House.
Well, what happened, as I understand it, is that Franklin and Eleanor's relationship, as important and productive as it was, had certain untended parts that they couldn't meet for one another. Eleanor wanted to travel all the time, and Franklin needed someone to take care of him. So one of the people living in this extended family, hotel-type White House, is his secretary, Missy LaHand, living on the third floor, really being his other wife, taking care of him when he's sick, helping him to have a poker game when he's grouchy, being his hostess at the cocktail hour.
And so, laughing at the same jokes.
That's right.
Told over
just
and
like
over
the good
again.
Wife is yeah. supposed to do. Eleanor would come in and say, Franklin, it didn't quite happen that way, because she was so honest. But Missy would just look adoringly at him. And because of his paralysis, he couldn't get out into the world for entertainment, for relaxation. So he needed gay conversation around him in the White House. It was his only way of relaxing. So Harry Hopkins had to be there. His daughter had to be there. Winston Churchill had to be there. I mean, he needed this group
about
of people.
How about the princess?
Well, this was a whole new person I hadn't known about, the Princess Martha of Norway, who was in exile during the war. Her son is currently the king of Norway. And he loved her conversation, her smile, her flirtation. So she was living on and off in the White House during this period of time as well.
Doris, you bring up a point that is so human, and I had not even thought of it. And yet, there it is. Franklin D. Roosevelt's fear of fire because of the paralysis, and his always needing to sleep with the door open.
I know. I mean, I hadn't known until I got into this, but evidently when he was a young boy, he had seen his aunt, who was only like 17 or 16, die from an accidental flame with a curling iron, and he saw her come down the steps. So he had this original fear of fire, but then when he got paralyzed, it became the only fear he had. He wasn't afraid of assassination, he wasn't afraid of anything else, but the fear that he'd be left in his bedroom and a fire would take place and he couldn't get out. So against the Secret Service's wishes, he wouldn't allow them to lock his bedroom door at night. And his son Jimmy tells of a time when he used to find his father sometimes crawling from his bed to the door, practicing what would happen if a fire did break out and nobody had come to get him.
That just sends goosebumps down you thinking
too.
Of that. Harry Hopkins and his relationship with Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
Well, Harry Hopkins is such an important person during this period of time. He really becomes Roosevelt's chief ally, friend, alter ego on foreign policy. He'd originally been involved as a social worker, as the head of the Work Projects Administration during the 30s, but Roosevelt intuitively understood, here's a man I can trust, here's a companion I can live with, and he actually asked him to live in the White House, so he's there as well. And he's the one who gets sent to visit Churchill before Roosevelt meets him to feel Churchill out. He goes to visit Stalin before Roosevelt meets him to bring back information about what's happening in Russia. Probably not since Colonel House under Wilson's administration had we had such an important advisor to a president as Harry Hopkins was.
He was very young at the time, because later when I discover it, when he dies, he's 55.
That's right.
So he must have started that relationship when he was still in his mid-30s.
That's right. When he, like so many other people, came to the New Deal, ideal in the early 30s. They were in their 30s. They were young people. That was that whole influx of excitement in the 1933 period to go to Washington. Harry Hopkins was one of those bright young men out of Iowa who came to Washington. And he really was an aide that Roosevelt could utterly trust. I mean, it was the perfect relationship for both of them, not only for work, but he knew when Roosevelt needed to relax. He could tell a funny story. He could enjoy the cocktail hour. He could do whatever Roosevelt needed at that moment in time.
Reading the book, Eleanor Roosevelt, whom I guess all women who have any sort of education has to admire, becomes even more of a towering figure. Beginning with, I mentioned that name, and you do in the book of the Odell Wallers, her concern for people of color.
It really is so far ahead of her time. I mean, she was out there on civil rights in ways that it was hard to imagine any other First Lady, anyone else in the administration being as far out as she was. The case you referred to is there was a young black man who was about to be executed in the South for a crime that seemed like it was self-defense, perhaps. His tenant owner, had pulled a gun on him, so it seemed, and he was just operating in self-defense. And the black community got exorcised about this and thought it was the failure of the jury system that he had been convicted. Eleanor fought for him to not be executed. She actually got Roosevelt to send a letter to the governor sort of hinting that maybe you don't use your pardon power enough, why don't you use it on this issue? When it didn't work, she almost wanted to interrupt him in the middle of planning for D-Day, for, you know, all these things that are going on. She never allowed herself to not be able to be relentless when she was fighting a cause like this. And at times, people would get irritated and upset with her. And in this case, Harry Hopkins was mad at her because he had more important things on his mind. But she thought nothing was as important as the life of one person who she thought was being taken unwisely.
She also opened the doors in the hospitality of the White House to people, again, of color.
Exactly so. I mean, people would come to the White House who had never been there before, and she would have a whole series of civil rights leaders and workers in and just sort of plunk them next to Roosevelt at dinner so he would have to listen to their concerns. She really became a voice for a whole segment of people, not only blacks, but women and migrant workers and poor people who would never have been in the White House. She brought them there and brought their concerns to her husband's ear.
And she was the first lady in the White House to say, "I will give press conferences, but only to the women reporters."
Oh, it was such an amazing thing.
Yeah.
As a result, I mean, very few newspapers in 1933 had women reporters. But now suddenly, Eleanor was only allowing women at her press conferences. Every national newspaper had to bring a woman aboard because she might say something important and they needed somebody there. A whole generation of female journalists got their start because of Eleanor's press conferences.
And she began, too, to write a column called My Day.